but it's one now.
Start with blessing. Baruch Ata Adonai Elohim Melech HaOlam Asher Notan Torah. Amen. All right. Isaiah chapter 24. Then we'll be talking about what section is on the scrolls over here? The collection of scrolls?
Condemnation inside of apocalypse.
That's apocalypse, that's apocalypse.
To give the end of the world.
It has to be part of one, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so we're gonna be discussing Isaiah's a collection of topics. The topical order of scrolls and chapters that we look at, where he goes into each chapter discussing different exciting things about things that are going to happen. And as we well know, the end of the world is a little bit harsh and exciting at the same time.
Actually, this is the first part of the debate about what's better, and it's like, on the one hand, it's hardly so. Jesus is coming that soon, and boy, he's in there, and he's like, it's gotta be in it now.
I
just see the car, and like the conditions.
Terrorizing the creatures. Alright, so we're gonna go to chapter 24. Okay, so we've gotta cover 24, 25, 26, and 27, right? Okay, so, since you guys are watching us, I said you all got like 14 million notes in all of your Bible notebooks and everything like that. Yes, you're going to come up with stuff in your plan, aren't we? What we're going to do is I'm going to read through stuff, and then we will stop and we'll ask some questions, okay? So, chapter 4, 24, verse 1. Look at Anai is stripping and destroying the land, turning it upside down and scattering its inhabitants. Cochin and Carmen are a slave and lost, a man and mistress, buyer and seller, lender and borrower, creditor and debtor. The land will be completely stripped, completely plundered. Nice beginning, right? Who is involved?
The whole world.
Everybody, okay? So even from a Kohen, even from the priesthood, is going to be dealing with this, okay? While I have spoken this word, the land fades and withers, the world walks and withers, the exalted in the land language. The land lies defiled under its inhabitants because they have transgressed the teachings, changed, or broken the everlasting covenant. Sound familiar?
Yes and no.
What is going on today? What does it mean for the land to be defiled?
Well, aren't we defiling it right now?
Sin.
Yeah.
Right?
Okay. Which would make the land what? Think about Saturday studies. We've been discussing very specific topics.
When did they defile the land also by not keeping the year Sabbath for that
special
year? Defile the land and not interest.
So because we have walked away from Torah, you have made the place unclean. That's a purity thing. Okay? Because they have transgressed the teachings and changed the Torah and broken the covenant. And then the last in covenant. Which covenant are we talking about?
He's talking about the one where Moses, hold on, I read it down. He's talking about, well, that's the thing, because he could be talking about all five of the covenants, or he could be talking about the one where Moses said, oh, Moses, where God said he'll never flood the earth again because of people's sin.
I think this is specifically his.
Are we talking about Noah?
It's about the covenant they're going to make, the way you can the broken it, and they carry on, the Lord carries on.
Which is both on top of which covenant?
On the Moses' laws.
Okay. Moses' laws indicates about the same thing.
I say it is both on Noah's one, because of the fact that when they sent Paul, then God did bring the flood and did wash him the earth. And then it says in Genesis
1. Noah's one was very specific when it came to, I will not flood the earth again, even though they have done this. We're talking about Noah's one because there wasn't a condition to it. even though he said now, nowhere does it say that because of the sins of Noah or any of his inheritance, now that you have to atone for everything that's there. Okay? Everybody has come in and now they've said, okay, look, this is what I promise I will never do again. I will not flood the earth again, even though we got that bad. Right? So his promise is that he will never do it. It's not exactly a conditional covenant. It's a covenant between man and God. It's a promise that he said, this is what will happen. And there is no second part to it.
Yeah,
right.
I did say
they were five. Yes, they are. Very good. Very good. So we start off, I don't think we're talking about Noah covenant. Okay? We mentioned the covenant as Sinai. No. Otherwise known as what we call the Ketubah, the wedding contract.
No. Wait, but the land was given because...
The land was given to...
Because of Abraham.
Because of this. The Abrahamic covenant has to come in there, right?
And the
land
was a promise to them because
they walked
through. Isn't
the
covenant
with
God said, I'll bless
your seed? Exactly. Circumcision sign is a symbol. Remember, the promise he made to Abraham actually gets overlapped with the promise he made to Isaac. It's overlapped with the promise he made to Jacob and leads these people into Sinai. And he says, because of the promises of Abraham, I will make the promise of Sinai. But each time he layer upon layer builds on top of it. Not one covenant like we discussed before. According to Galatians, the later covenant does not nullify the promises made before. It does not take it away. Okay? Check me out in Galatians. Yeah. Which means you are not to take it away. Galatians 3 specifically says the promises that are sitting on top of it. Okay? Double check me on my reference, please. Okay, so if by honoring this promise led to Isaac inheriting the promise, led to Jacob inheriting the promise, led to Israel and the sons of, or the Hebrews inheriting the promise, okay, which put them into the promised land, this is the promise we start talking about, okay, the everlasting covenant, alright, it will be there forever, okay, which is kind of interesting. God will, how do I know that covenant is everlasting? Wait.
Oh, he said, a few places.
Okay.
Genesis 17, verse 7.
Well, what does it say?
It's,
wait,
I'm going
to go there. Genesis 17, verse 7.
I have to write it down. Hold on, I'm going there.
And we know it's an everlasting covenant.
Because it's I've heard of
everlasting ordinances.
Are you talking about not just Abraham but also Moses because it was a few times?
Yeah, well this is what we need to test, right?
Well, Genesis 17 verse 7 says, and I will establish my covenant between me and you and your descendants after you in the generations for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your descendants after you.
Right. Okay, what is it?
And 9 verse 16 also says, the rainbow shall be in the cloud, and I will look on it to remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of flesh, of all flesh that is on earth. But that is the other.
Yeah, I think about what was Abraham one?
17 verse 7.
Okay.
No, that's where the lower one comes from, and then the next one.
Genesis 17, right? It's an everlasting covenant, so that means again, modern from Messiah covenant, modern from the new covenant gets established. Each covenant is built on top of another covenant which is going to establish and bring us closer to the fulfillment of that, i.e., it's going to bring us to the truth of that, it's going to establish that. And remember, the term fulfill is to establish it, right? So, because they have walked away from the instruction, because they have changed God's Torah and broken the covenant, therefore a curse is devouring the land and its inhabitants will be punished for the guilt. It is why they're living their waste away and the people left a few. The new wine fails, the wine will and the river sigh. And happy son of tambourine seasons, the sons of mirror makers are still. The joy of the lyre ends. They will no longer sing and they drink as they drink their wine. Strong liquor tastes bitter to those drinking it. The city of chaos is shattered. Every house closed up. No one can enter. In the streets they are crying over the wine. All joy has faded. Cheer has left the land. In the city only desolation in the gates of that and beyond repair. He's actually citing from a very, very, very important portion. What is happening? Transgression of Torah led to the desolation and the wilderness of the land. What transgression? What portion? Where does God warn them? What does he say? If you walk away, if you stick with me, this will happen. If you don't stick with me, then this will happen. I put before you blessing and the curse of death.
Start the believers.
I'm thinking of something a little bit off now.
I was going to say something
before.
I was going to say Genesis 3, verse 17. Basically,
I eat
from the tree of knowledge
and
good and evil. And then God said,
now you have said. That's all creation. I want you to mark that. Yeah, very interesting portion.
It's under Leviticus 26, verse 14.
Okay, let's see what it says.
But if you do not obey me and do not observe all these commandments, and if you despise my statutes, where your soul appalls my judgment, so that you cannot perform all my commandments that break my covenant, I also will do this to you. I will even appoint terror over you, wasting diseases and fever, which shall consume the eyes and cause sorrow of the heart, and you shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemies shall eat it. I will set my face against you, and you shall be defeated by your enemies. Those who hate you shall reign over you, and you shall flee.
No, I don't think we get it just for that.
Is it 14-2?
26-14.
Wait until you hear this. But if you refuse to pay attention to what underlying God says, do not observe and obey all of the mitzvot and the regulations that I am giving you to today, and all the following curses will be yours in abundance. A curse on you in your city, a curse on you in the countryside, a curse on your grain basket and kneading bowl, a curse on the fruit of your body and fruit of your land and the young and the cattle and flocks, a curse when you come in and a curse when you go out. Notice how he says, your land is desolate, your people are problematic, and even the gates are battered. Deuteronomy 28. Okay? Deuteronomy 28, 27, well, I think we'll go into, if you follow me, these are the blessings. And it goes into this beautiful long list of things that's going to be on. And it goes straight from there and goes, now you receive the good stuff of what can happen to you if you follow God's instruction. This is what happens to you, God.
Sorry,
28? 28, verse 15. Okay? I think he's very much making a case here, stating, look around you, and as God said, first in the country, first in the city. First, the fruit of your children here are suffering. The land is suffering. You cannot go in or out without knowing what's gates. Everything is broken. Everything is bad. This is the fruit of your creation. This is the fruit of your labors. Every now and again we need a text stop. Every now and again we need a stop and we need to see what we are doing. God will allow us to sow, water, and plant things that are not obvious. Because we need to see what that brings. Okay? Sometimes God will not stop you. You will sow dissension, it will bring dissension. You will gossip, and you will talk, and you will run amok, and you will live a worldly life and run around out there. This is what you're going to have. Destruction, you're going to have heartache, you're going to run into a brick wall, and all of a sudden you look up and you don't know how you got. What was it that I was doing that got me so far away from God? What was it that I was doing that was causing dissension between people I love? What was it that I was doing that led to this destruction? This is what Israel is telling to me. Every now and again we need to stop and we need to look at where we are. What is it that I'm growing? What is it that I'm harvesting? What is it that I'm feeding? Because the more you start to push those buttons, the more God tries to, remember, you've got two different aspects of this. God will purify you and give, make sure that your heart is good, pretty good. Or, you run away, you push, you grumble, you moan, you do whatever you need to do, and you break. Israel is so far detached in this portion that they even decided to change God's Torah. Unthinkable. But today we do it all the time. Your truth, my truth, their truth. This is how you do it, this is how I do it, this is what God says.
You can choose.
You can choose what you want, how you want, and do the rest. Again, if this is an everlasting ordinance that God is holding up against you, you broke my covenant, you're changing my Torah, you're ignoring my teachings, my instructions, those are all for your blessing. You choose whether or not you're going to safeguard them. That's a very nice word. To safeguard something means that it's precious to you and that you want to keep it safe.
How do you get across to people that their loss is their loss and not their loss is up to Yeshua and then it's not up to their loss?
Tell them to literally read the Bible. It says everlasting, not until Yeshua comes. Remember, when you come up to someone and you start talking about that, well, they're all in a very Greek thinking where new, you have old, you have things, you had a covenant, and then the covenant got overrun by that covenant, got overrun by that covenant, got overrun by that covenant. So Greek thinking, one time. This contract overrules the other contracts previously because now we are talking about a newer contract. It's an updated world that nullifies everything that exists. But you're not talking about a world. You're talking about wedding vows. You do not nullify what you said on your wedding day. When you on your 25th wedding anniversary, you get up and you renew your vows. Those are newer vows. Does it nullify what you believed in before? No, absolutely not. It reaffirms everything that you've been doing over the last 25 years.
You know what I've learned is people will believe what they want to do. It's true. It's just you might say that. You can't say that. You can't have any more.
No.
Spread light or something. And watching these debates is showing me how hard people's hearts can be. Because you will put the evidence right in front of them and they'll just be like, they will choose not to be.
This is the thing. Guys, when you have suspicion, we're talking about leadership, right? When you come into contact with someone who does not have you, let me advise you on the way that seems to, that God has allowed us to develop over the years. Let me see kind of this. I come up to Grammy, I look at his funny tassels, and I go, what's that about? Oh, no, this, you know, oh, you don't know what this is. This is what, you know, this is what the Bible says, and this is why I do it. It's a personal thing for me. And then walk away.
And you're not going to feel judged or like you can't commit it that much.
This is why I do it. But in the Bible it says this is what it means, and this is why I enjoy learning. This is very special to me. Pause for effect. And walk away. Let them think about it. Let them mull it over. Let them develop that sense of, okay. What else do you do? Why don't you go to the shops on Saturday? On Saturday. Everything's open Saturday. Well, God said to go to rest on Sabbath, and we found out that actually Sabbath is on Friday night to Saturday night, and we did some research, and you know what? It's been a real blessing to me to stay away from you. This is why you should be doing it. This is why people need to see the beneficial side of God's instruction. So that they don't think it's like this massive condemnation, this massive issue that's coming into their life, and now all of a sudden you kept them earlier than now. It took us a long, long, hard look at ourselves and the way we were behaving to be able to go, okay, Lord, this is what I need to do. And like I said to you guys before, people are watching you more than what you realize, and now you are being that light, you are being that reflection, that motion to saying, okay, this is God, this is what He wants. But I don't, when you come from a very Christian one-sided thing, and you look at the way they interpret the Old Testament, they're saying, oh, you're doing it out of fear. You're doing it because you're scared you're going to get a lightning bolt point. No. Yeah, you're doing it to achieve salvation. No. Yeshua said, if you love me, you keep my instructions. love, nothing less.
Somehow those instructions aren't easy ones.
No, this is why unfortunately Christians have this little short circuit. In a normal place, they don't understand, and this is the same thing, you know, when we went in, we sat on the beach, and I've had this time and time again, when you go to these guys and you discuss these things, and they really see the good, and they can't argue that this is good, and they're like, wow, this is real. But, always the famous line, where do we draw the line? Because they don't understand Galatians. It's very simple. God says, I see neither Jew, the Gentile, man or woman, slave or free. There's no difference between you. If you belong to me, you belong to me. It's very simple. You either belong to me and you follow my ways, or you belong to the world. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. It is not a Jewish thing to do. It is a God thing to do. It is not the law of Moses. It is the law of God. These are not Moses' feasts or Jewish feasts. These are God's feasts. And this is what we need to start to transfer in our discussions with these people.
Like you said, they only hear what
you're saying. Yes. Yeah. Imagine
if
your
family
don't want to give back. Smile, this is what I do. You really? Why we do. And then they look at you and they go, do you think we should do it? Open door. No. But if they walk up to you and then they go, well, that's just legalistic and rubbish.
Walk up to you and say, go read Galatians.
I did. It's fascinating. You know?
It's
fascinating. Did you know that not one covenant nullifies another covenant according to Galatians? Did you read that? Did you find that interesting? Anglo-Saxon pale guy with long combed hair with his lovely trimmed beard standing there in some sort of out garment, inner garment, but no tzitzit, no talit, no pesach table, standing in the middle, going, this is it. And when you go to Asia, you have Asian Jesus. You have him standing there, he has eyes that are smart and they have made him Asian. And then you have other people that are very proud, African, and are like, Jesus is black.
But he was.
He wasn't white and he wasn't Ethiopian. Okay? And you're standing over there and think, what we do is we personalizing because he looks like me, he acts like me, he understands me in this, and we forget that he was the Lion of Judah. We forget that he will come back. You know, there was one argument I was listening to, a guy say, you know, white guy was giving a lecture, and he came up to him and he said, don't you know that the physical is all passed away and that the flesh is worth nothing and all the rest of it? You know, why do you keep on hammering on that Jesus was a Jew? And he says, yeah, but you missed one important problem. He says, he came as a human man. He lived as a Jew. He died as a Jew. He was the Lion of Judah. And when he comes back, it says he will come back as the Lion of Judah into Jerusalem, where he will live and reign forever. Of course, even in the Messianic age, he will be a Hebrew. And people want to over-spiritualize it. They want to allegorize it. They want to make it fit their theology. And that's the problem.
Also, Hebrews cross over.
Well, how many of you knew that before we came?
There's a lot that we take for granted that people don't know. Like I spoke to one about last week. We didn't even know Sabbath was on the Sabbath, but it was Sunday.
Yeah, because they didn't call Sunday Sabbath. The seventh day is the seventh day of our week. Did we ever stop and question which kind of day we're talking about? Did we ever stop and question? No, his name is Jesus. Oh, actually, that's Greek. Did we ever stop and question how he walked, what he said, where he lived? No.
Well, look at the plural people that didn't know any Jews, because they passed away
again, you must understand, what we do by following Torah is not to earn your salvation.
But they believed in God.
They believed that Yeshua died for their sins, whether they called him Jesus or Yeshua was the same thing. And they went and they believed in that. They believed that their sins were paid for, they're saved. There's no issue. Unfortunately, what they've missed is they've missed the blessing of following God's instruction. Yeah. How much joy has it brought you to celebrate Pesach? How much joy has it come in to have a Shabbat? How much joy has it come in to celebrate the feast and live according to His ways? That's what Torah does.
I think more than that, also, you learn so much more about Him. The Father, you learn about what He wants to do. So that brings you a lot of joy. You know, I've known that you're teasing Him, that you're doing things that. He's given that table to you and saying, it's open. And you can come.
Yeah, and he gets disappointed when you do wrong things, and he gets disappointed when you don't come, and he gets disappointed when things happen. But, like it says, when you do these things, when you bring a smile to his face, he's happy. He loves it, it's beautiful. And people think it's legalistic, and bondage, slavery, deluded. And just understand what God is all about. Because they've been told. They've been taught bad.
Same as I mean, honestly.
They've been taught bad. So we smile and we wave, and you go, okay, we'll just wait. Want to see, let them think about it. If they don't want to hear about it, walk away. This is why we do it, okay? So, everything is broken, God says. Around the earth, among the peoples, it will be as when beating an olive tree, as when gleaning the grapes at the end of the harvest. What does that mean?
Gleaning the grapes.
Gleaning the grapes at the end of the harvest, beating the olive tree.
Because when you glean the grapes, it's not an evil for the people's hearts, so there's not abundance.
Among the nations, they will be picking up the last little bit. That's where I find it very interesting. He uses two very interesting pictures. The olive tree.
Oil to Martin and
Nora. Not just that. And the olive trees are reference to?
To Yeshua. No, to Israel.
To Israel?
Yeah.
Once you're beating the olive tree, he's talking about judgment. He's going to get every little bit of fruit that's left. And you're gleaning the grapes, the vine. Thank you. And they lift their voices, singing for joy, shouting from the west to honor Adonai, notice, of the nations, the Goyim. So in the east, honor Adonai. In the coastlands, honor the name of Adonai, the God of Israel. From the furthest part of earth, we have heard them sing, glory to the righteous one, to the Tzaddik. So at this time, he all of a sudden goes from this harsh tribulation to, or this harsh judgment, all of a sudden to, the world will know. Everybody will see. Everybody will sing and they will honor his name. But I say I'm wasting away, I'm wasting away. Woe to me, traitors betray. Oh, how the traitors betray and betray. Terror, pit, and trap are upon you. You who are living on earth, he who flees at the sound of terror shall fall into a pit. He who climbs up out of the pit will be caught in a trap. For the windows above have been opened and earth's foundation shaken. The earth cracks and breaks open, the earth crumbles in pieces, the earth trembles and totters, the earth staggers to and fro like a drunk, sways back and forth like a watchman's shelter. Its transgressions weighs heavy upon it, it will fall and not rise again. When that day comes, Adonai will punish the armies on the high heaven on high, and the kings of the earth here on earth. They will be assembled like prisoners in a dungeon and shut up in prison to be punished many years. Then the moon will be confused and the sun ashamed, and Adonai Tzevaot will rule on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem with its glory manifest to the rulers of his people. What happens?
Very much like Revelations.
It is Revelation.
Yeah.
He's having a moment of clarity on what gets actually reaffirmed by John later on in Scripture. He's talking about the end times where God will say, the principalities that are up in heaven, Hasatan and his cronies, all the people that are on earth that are in charge, that have walked away from him, heaven will be open. Time is now. Every knee will bow. Every time will confess. That is the time when God comes in and no one can deny to his kingdom.
I was reading commentary and they said that, I don't know if it's true or not, that the heavens, God is
going to
be angry with those in heaven too, like
he was
angry with
the
well,
heaven,
that's
Hasatan
and
Hasatan. Remember, anything that has, just like in Pesach, remember, God didn't go, okay, that's it, I'm going to kill every Egyptian. He said, no. Those who, I'm going to go out against the gods of Egypt.
Okay.
Demonic forces that have led other people straight from the one to Creator. They know who God is. And he's going to start cleaning us from top and come down the bottom. So you must understand, the Creator and the Created, the Created will have to answer to the Creator. It's very simple. And angels and all the rest of it that they've chosen wrong are also created beings, and they will also suffer punishment and judgment. They will have to answer to the fruit that they have sown. And if he's doing that up there, make sure he's going to do it now.
It's interesting because he mentions the host of heavens. He talks specifically about that because if you look at the relations, there's a time when God says to say that it's enough because he's a great accuser. And it talks about, he stands, it talks about him accusing the saints that are not at the throne. And there's a time where it's enough is enough.
And then he will be crossed out. It's a very interesting study. If you really want to terrorize your brain a little bit, try and figure out when that happened, or if it has happened.
Yeah, well.
When Hasatan was actually crossed out and he was very angry, you actually take a look at this, and some of us will actually say, happened, and some of us are saying it's coming, and some of us are saying it's just sort of in the... Okay? It's a very interesting study. Go and have a look if you've got some data. Okay?
It seems as... But you know, there's always one hand and one hand.
Yeah.
Seems as if it's still going to happen because of where they're talking about it.
James Revelation. The same year. Some actually commentary saying that actually happened just by the way you are trying to come here.
He's saying that when he's saying what's up, but yeah, because he's still like going by and shows.
That's just building a boat here. When you talk about Revelations, you'll get cast down and he'll actually go in and attack God's people. And it'll be a time of tribulation more. I actually think it's still going to happen. Yeshua is saying, I have already seen it, past tense. But it could be a prophecy.
It could be
prophetic.
Yeah, but it could also be that Hasatan was cast out because of his pride. But he still accuses the saints before the fall. Just like Job, when he came before, it's like, oh no, he's not there. But God would just talk to God because I have never spoken to God since. But then Job's the same thing. He came to God and he accused Job, or he said, you know, if this guy's only serves you because you give him everything. It's another example.
But that's the point where he would still be in communication with God, but I believe when he gets cast out, that's it, it's done.
Yeah, but I think that's what's coming here.
Yes. That's an interesting, thing.
He's accusing the saints now, but the time will come when enough is enough. He's had his accusation and he'll be finished.
Is it not coinciding with the time in Revelation, I'm confident with the verse where they say the Holy Spirit will be removed from you, and that's where the real tribulation will happen? Because that's when Satan and his little cronies can do whatever they want to, whereas right now they're still being held back.
It's a possibility, maybe before the rapture and after the rapture. It depends on whether you believe it's going to happen. They're going to be, the people who have been going to the Royal Revelation will be taken out, and then we won't be there, which is what I think is going to happen. But, and then there will be Cohen and then these guys who are supposed to be acting like priests, but aren't really doing anything, they're not doing what they should be. So it could be this tribulation period that is going to take place just before judgment. And where the saints won't be there. So that's interesting. Okay? What we do find is that it overlaps quite a bit. Alright, 25. Allah, O my God, I exalt you, I praise your name, for you have accomplished marvels, fulfilled ancient plans faithfully and truly. For you have made a city a heap of stones, turned a fortified city into rubble, made the foreigner's fortress a city that will never be built. Therefore, mighty peoples glorify you, the city of ruthless nations fears you, for you have been a refuge for the poor, a refuge to the for the needy in distress. Shelter from the storm, shade from the heat, and the blast from the ruthless was like a storm that could destroy a wall. Like desert heat, you subdued the foreigner's uproar, like heat subdued by the bloodshed. The song of the ruthless dies away. On this mountain, Adonai Tzevaot will make for all the peoples a feast of rich food and superb wines, delicious rich food and superb elegant wines. On this mountain, they will destroy the veil which covers the face of all peoples. Which mountain are we talking about? On this mountain, Adonai will make for all peoples a feast of rich food and superb wines.
Well, it makes sense,
Sinai,
because that's where the marriage took place.
What about Jerusalem?
On the
sea,
yeah,
that's
interesting. And that's where
it's going.
Okay.
Okay.
Like the
new Jerusalem. Okay. It could be an illusion to what will happen, yeah. On this mountain, he will destroy the veil which covers the face of all peoples. Surely he's talking about which veil?
A blindness?
Who's got it on right now?
The scales.
Jewish people,
mainly got the sun, but the world also being blinded by the veil enshrining all the nations. He will swallow up death forever. All of a sudden, there's a veil, he doesn't know, and then there's this motion of death disappearing. Adonai Elohim will wipe away the tears from every face. He will remove from all the earth the disgrace his people suffer. Adonai has spoken. On that day, will say, see, this is our God. We waited for him to save us. This is our life. We put our hope in him. We are full of joy. So glad he saved us. For on this mountain, the hand of God will have grace. But Moab will be trampled down where they are like straw trampled in the pile of Midian. They will spread out their hands in Moab like a swimmer using their hands to tread water. But their pride will be humbled and sunk. No matter how clever the strokes of their hands, your high fortified walls will be leveled. Strike to the ground, lay in the dust. What do you have about that up and going?
What do you think about
that? Yeah, what do you think about that?
Well, I think, you know, it talks about the city walls. It could be even referring all that to some Gomorrah being turned to dust. Also, when they cross the Jordan.
Could represent, you know, the nations before.
Okay. Arrogant peoples, right?
But then also Jerusalem gets their ways.
Let me see how we learn that. Let's explore. We're going to note each other. One says Revelation 21 verse 4. Go there and look at that.
Revelation?
21 verse 4. And then we've got the other correlating passage we can talk about, Matthew 24.
Revelation 1 verse 4.
Revelation 21.
21 verse 4 for chapter 5. Book chapter 25.
And see what correlations pop up.
Revelation
21 verse 4 and Matthew chapter 24. Okay? Have this quiz in your Bible. Tell me if you see anything. Look at what holds up to the destruction. standing firm, the keeping of Torah, so that your love will stay close to God. Thing is, when you start looking at this, the instruction is paused. Because I promise God that they will do what they were called to do in a specific plan for a specific purpose. And they forgot that for a specific purpose. And when we look at what we've been called to do, you are actually the priests. You have the same function. Wherever you are, you have to be a light. You have to be like salt. You're supposed to be there to be able to reach out to everyone in love and humility. And we are to make like Yeshua. How would he... Tell me something about Yeshua. When he was dealing with... Tell me then, in the beginning, when they made a boo-boo, what did he do? How did he act? get to a point as tell me then, socials, where you have to start and focus exactly on what the example that you have to be. As leaders, you will have to be able to walk and check and move forward in exactly the way Yeshua acted. And the simple reason is they don't need you. They don't need your example. They don't need your understanding. They need God.
You know, it's funny. Now people always speak about the Bible, like it's Bible times. But if you like, if you actually understand what's happening, and you have a relationship, you kind of start feeling like you're filtering in, and it's like you realize it's actually, now it's just continuing from him.